On behalf of organizers, I'll welcome Mr. Sumit Joge, Mr. Yeshwant Rao, Mr. Niranjan Naik, Nitin Sharma, and Sushant Sashit, Satish. So I think...
And yourself.
And thank you. So I think we have a mix of somebody from energy storage, somebody from the developer, and of course under guidance of Shinde Saab. I would like to have each one of you to give us the current state, what is happening, though it is very nicely narrated by Shinde Saab. But in reality, most of the people who are working in the sector have a little bit of dilemma in mind, and have a most of the people who have already invested have some kind of frustration. So I would like to, each one of you to have to explain in 2 to 5 minutes what is the current status, and how do you think the current state, what is the reason behind the current state of state in solar sector in Maharashtra and overall India for that matter. So we'll start with Mr. Sumit.
Hello. Yeah, good morning, designated authorities, and also thanks a lot, Kishorji, for giving such an enlightening presentation. Few policies we are already aware, few obviously with this presentation give us a lot of understanding about overall sector in Maharashtra and what different options can be there. Just to introduce myself, this is Sumit Joge from Sprng Energy. To introduce our organization, Sprng Energy is the newly created platform of Actis, which is again private equity investor. We are basically an IPP into wind and solar both, and just to give you a background, presently we have two projects under development. First is which we have won through reverse auction in the month of February. And it is at the rate of 2.977 and 3.30 is the levelized tariff for the same, which is 250 megawatt. And total, it is being developed in solar park, which is of 750 megawatt. The good part of the project is that there are two more developers and the total solar park size is 750 megawatt, I guess, which is one of the largest right now in India. The next project which recently we have won again in wind sector, in RE sector, so it is in Gujarat. The tender was being conducted by GUVNL, and again that project we have won at 2.43 at the levelized tariff. So these are the two projects, and further we have the plan to build a pipeline and say projects in India around about 2 gigawatt is the mandate. We are also trying to expand our operations into Southeast Asian markets, especially Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, those countries which are the new area. So these are the this is brief about our organization. Just to have a look at it, almost have spelled out everything what we are doing. And then this is 250 megawatt and Gujarat wind, which is 197.5 megawatt. Now, just to understand about the sector, already through Kishoji, a lot of opportunities are coming up. But in terms of utility scale, most of the utility scale projects are being conducted through tenders, as everyone of us are aware of. And recently, in last, say, 15 days, these are the few tenders which have come up. And here again, you can see Maharashtra has taken a lead with MSEDCL 1000 megawatt tender. This is in solar. They have one more tender of 500 megawatt in, say, wind. Bagas is also there, 200 megawatt. So this is for Maharashtra. Then next three again come up through SECI, which is 275 megawatt tender. Then 200 megawatt, 750 megawatt, all being developed in solar park in different states. Then last, fifth one is again SECI, CTU. This is 215 to 8 projects to be connected to ISTS, CTU, and this is again 2 gigawatt. And then recently, UP NEDA has announced their 1,000 megawatt to be developed in the state of UP. All these first five are surely going to happen through reverse auction. And we have seen how the reverse auction moves on, which has helped overall to bring in the tariffs at the level where government can afford and DISCOM can consider those tariffs in the merit order as well. In rooftop also, there are a lot of opportunities across the country, and especially Maharashtra is, I guess, is leading in rooftop sector as well. Railways and PSUs have their PP opportunities where investors can come into play, and next year it is expected to more than 100 megawatt. EPC tenders being conducted by IOCL, HPCL and other PSUs as well. In fact, CIL has also taken up the tender of 200 megawatt. Then net metering has itself created a new business opportunities across the sector, wherein we might have heard a lot of PPAs being signed by private industries or private consumers, which are again at very competitive rate and also are offering a different type of segment for all the rooftop sector put together. Then there are few tenders being created by defense also. Defense is largely releasing large scale tenders. Recently, few 1.1 megawatt, 2 megawatt, 3 megawatt, such type of, with the combination of ground mounted and rooftop both put together. Now next is Smart City initiative itself has created a good impact, wherein rate contract, say, for tier 1, tier 2 cities, that is coming up in a great way. So these are the few opportunities, but obviously with opportunities we have forces which stop them. As initially Kishorji suggested, that there are few areas where we face the issues. These are the few of them which I have highlighted. First, everyone knows anti-dumping duty, which might be imposed and might affect the rates altogether, which will be further discussed during panel discussion as well. GST impact, GST has overall done a good for the complete country as a sector also, but only few issues where PPAs were signed quite before the implementation of GST. There is still lot of things to be taken care where impact of GST to be taken care in PPAs, that is not clear. How earlier the project cost and what was the difference in tax and how DISCOMs has to consider that those impacts, that is not yet clear. So MNR is already in procedure to develop a procedure so that these PPAs don't suffer. Then as we are seeing that with the present all grid infrastructure is based on thermal, and with RE coming in, it is intermittent power as we know. So there are few issues of grid stability, which again battery storage might help it to, battery storage especially at grid level will be helpful. And our designated authority again, Nitin is, I guess, is the right person who can help us in that area. Then last project where, last point wherein for rooftop sector, everyone is entering into PPA, but again few bigger size players, wherein some companies which are risk, don't want to take a higher risk, are not able to enter into this area because of legal framework, wherein penalties can be imposed to the customers is not yet in place. So strong enforceable legal framework will again help us to grow this sector all together. So with this, I am done for the thing and would invite.
Thank you, Sumit.
Thanks.
You have presentation or you can just briefly? Yeah, I can sit here.
Hello. Hello. So just to introduce myself, I'm Yeshwant Rao from Oriano Solar from Mumbai. We are basically a EPC company doing EPC for rooftop as well as ground mount projects. We have completed till now about 125 megawatt, rooftop plus ground mount projects. So, I think that one of the topic that we we would like to discuss is, impact of current, changes in structures of, customs duty. And last one or two days, there has been some news with respect to, the other duty, 70% duty possibility of being, applied. So, I remember the time 4 or 5 years back when, people used to talk about solar tariffs, whether there is a grid parity or not. So last 2-3 years, there has been no...
I think the voice is not clear.
See, last 2-3 years, nobody was discussing about grid parity because solar price had already, was much lower than the grid prices. And, we have seen the boost in terms of government tenders as well as, the private customers going for solar power as an option as against their grid power, basically. With the latest developments of, I was just discussing with Kishorji also just before our conference started, that what is going to be the impact of this and how we want to, take it forward in terms of, talking with the governments to reconsider this impact of these duties. Because I think that with the coming in for the customs duties and this safeguard duty, basically it will definitely increase the capital cost for the project, and it will have a impact on, ultimately increasing the solar tariff and the gap between the grid tariff and solar tariff would go down. And on the one side, again, solar tariff has to compete against the other renewable energies or other sources of energies like wind and other forms of energies. So the question is about the, attractiveness of solar power. I think that is one of the point we, as solar industry, we need to look at this and discuss further, basically.
Like you to just say a few words on the competitive bidding, what is happening now, the change from FIT model to regime to competitive bidding, whether the generator or the investor is comfortable having this change happening so quickly in solar sector, your views on that. Change from FIT to competitive bidding, because everybody has targeted with FIT a lot, very good rate offered by regulators. And unfortunately, before any projects come in on the ground, the competitive bidding has started and the rates had dropped down to say 260 or 240 or something like that. So from the investor point of view, they are, even today in India, most of the project, the finance is available at say 10% or 11%. And with the tariff of 260, is it viable, or how the developers are looking from their point of view?
So actually, we are not a developer ourselves.
As an EPC player, EPC it will affect player. You, because if the investors are not coming, what EPC will you do?
Yeah, absolutely. See, and the impact on us as a EPC is, as the tariffs go down, the expectation of developers with respect to EPC price also goes down.
That's what I'm saying. If the tariff is decided, then everybody down the line has to be squeezed.
Absolutely.
So the EPC, they will have the EPC at the low rate, they will have panels, they want panels at the very low rate,
yes.
They want the land at very low rate, they want all the infrastructure to be created at low rate. So
yes.
How does it affecting the EPC player, since you are a EPC player, how does it squeezing from or getting sandwiched from all the sides?
One word I can say is badly affecting the EPC companies. But I think your question, whether it's viable or not, I think the very fact that the developers are bidding at these rates means that they find the viability at these prices, and they're bidding these rates.
Yeah, true. But Shinde sir, the competitive bidding, the people are bidding, But have you seen there is a shift, because now there is no market for individual investor, the smaller investor, because unless and until you have a large scale projects scaling at 250 megawatt or so, and then getting 250 or 264 is viable. But for a small investor, suppose I'm an investor, I want to invest 2 megawatt of solar, where do I go?
For small investors, as it's rightly pointed out, the competitive is really very hard. The margins with which the people are working, if you just try to go into their shoes and just try to see, the margins are really very, very sharp and narrow. But what happens once a chance or option is been given for competitive bidding, and if the peoples are unable to realize the impact over a larger period of time, it's quite possible that the smaller developers or the EPC contractors are the peoples who are going to get squeezed out on a huge amount. Now, if you just try to see as far as the cost of the system's installation is concerned, there has been a huge swing which is taking place in the market. The model price are going up, going down because of n numbers of reasons, again coming up because of n numbers of reasons. So as far as the costing is concerned, we are trying to see there is a huge amount of shift which is taking place, and actually that is what is really an alarming signal, that because of which the people are unable to project the actual costing over a period of time. Though the gestation period for this installation is quite small, still within that shorter amount of time it is becoming a very difficult proposals. Now as far as the government is concerned, when the government is trying to make some decisions, it is trying to see that it needs to satisfy all the stakeholders who are coming in the loop. And in doing so, it's natural that some of the stakeholders are getting the benefits, some of the stakeholders are being demotivated. But whatever is the best, whatever optimization can be done, it is the role of the government to see and try to get it done at an optimized level.
But at the same time, if you have seen the DISCOM perspective, though the FIT is available, they are bypassing that FIT and going for competitive bidding. And then also asking earlier PPA which has been signed to match the rate with the competitive bidding. So do you think that DISCOM initiative or DISCOM direction to do this is a viable thing, or it's against justice to common investors?
Here I would like to give few views which will be my personal views, and some of them as from the government point of view. As far as the personal views are concerned, I will say that as far as dishonoring the PPAs which is done, I personally feel it is totally wrong. So government should try to take initiative, and they are trying to take an initiative that once a PPA has been signed, they shouldn't be dishonored, or it should be obeyed in true sense or full sense.
Okay. I'd like to have Mr. Niranjan Naik from Bosch. I think, can you highlight something which is happening on safeguard duty or import duty, which is now the new word being talked about, and whether the same competitive bidding will sustain with that import duty or safeguard duty? Now the new word has come out, safeguard duty, whether it will have the impact on PV. Of course, that will have some impact on import being coming from China, because last 2 years it is a huge import coming from China, and it is to safeguard Indian manufacturers, that can be understood. But are the Indian manufacturers are capable of producing such a high requirement, and how it will take forward?
Okay. I will start the brief introduction about myself, yeah. Bosch, and then I'll come to your... Okay, I'm Niranjan. I handle I'm the national sales head for Bosch Energy and Building Solutions. Bosch Energy and Building Solutions is a part of Bosch India, where we are there in India from 1951. Bosch basically is a 130-year-old company based out of Germany with about 73 billion euro. We are there almost in about 65 countries. In India, we are there. We are almost about 7 different companies with 15 manufacturing locations, almost 30,000 people, and about 18,000 crores. But Bosch Energy and Building Solutions is a very small part of the Bosch India. I must say that we are a kind of a startup. We definitely do not have the kind of, the muscle power or the kind of this thing, even though we have a turnover very high, to go for the likes of Sprng Energy, the way they have quoted and got it. The price at tariff levels of 2.97, or the recent ones, which is Badla phase 3, or the ones where they have quoted 2.47 or 2.3.0, very fancy rates at this point of time. We are highly focused on being a highly engineering oriented company with lot of focus on innovation, and we are very focused on the commercial and industrial space. We feel that the distributed solar segment, rooftop segment, would be the ones which is going to be sustainable over a period of time. So we are very highly focused on the rooftop segment, and specifically in the commercial and industrial segment, that's what we are focused on. And we are there in a small way in the utility segment. We have done projects such as Cochin International Airport or a Bangalore International Airport, New Mangalore Port Trust, wherever Bosch is more focused into the transport segment or into the railway segment or into automotive segment. Those are the segments where we are there, because we are trying to capitalize on the cross-selling initiatives of various companies of Bosch, and we are trying to offer a comprehensive solution. We are basically the only few company which are offering also energy solutions on the supply side, which is PV, and as well as the demand side with energy efficiency solutions to various industries. Now, coming back to what you are talking about, so we are, it is very surprising for us that obviously companies like Sprng Energy or the other big energy companies are going for rates which are very fancy. For us at this point of time, with the countervailing duty of 8.2% and with the safeguard duty, what they are talking about, 70%, if you ask me whether I know anything about it, I'm as clueless as any one of them here. Seems to be, I don't know whether a figure of 2.97 can be reached, because we discussed a few minutes back whether it makes sense for an EPC. With this kind of prices, it definitely doesn't make sense. But obviously, when they have, when somebody has come up with such kind of a price, there would be certain logic. They would have had certain parameters which they would have considered to arrive at this particular price. But in the near short term, I don't think this will be applicable at all. I mean, such kind of prices. Secondly, this also puts the pressure on the distributor rooftop segment as well. So when we go out to companies, it could be XYZ companies, they all read the papers. And today everybody knows about the rates. I mean, today the rates, tariff rates are so very interesting that it's become a topic of discussion. So when we sit down and discuss on a rooftop solution of 500 kilowatt, 200 kilowatts or a megawatt, somebody is asking these fancy rates as well. So it's a challenging thing for any EPC player or a developer or probably a financial investor to come out with investments which make sense. And today that brings us to the topic of this whole industry has become with so very low entry barriers that anybody can become an EPC player or anybody can get into the financial investments, which brings the pressure back on the kind of quality of installation takes place. Today a financial investor has to survive with about 13% or 14% or 15% IRR rates or probably even lesser. He has to have an installation which is set up which works for the next 25 years. We have to ask this fundamental question whether the solar projects which are set up, would it last for the next 25 years? And you will see the Bridge to India survey report which says that a lot of CEOs in the solar industry have talked about 56% or 60% of the solar installations today are not up to the mark. So which brings it back to the same question, are these tariff rates or the present challenges which each one of us in the industry are going through, is it sustainable? And if it is sustainable, and with the new Make in India approach by the government, which is really excellent, the Indian manufacturers definitely do not have the kind of manufacturing capacities. Now Adani has set up a capacity of 1 gigawatt, but still if the manufacturing, if you see, is far lower. If you look at Waaree or you look at these other players who are there, even their capacities have not increased. So when we are talking about 8 gigawatts which we are installed in 2017, correct me if I'm wrong, I mean it might be here and there, and do we have the capacities to sustain that kind of requirements, what is going to be there for the next coming years? And with, if you have to go as per the plan, vision plan of Honorable Prime Minister to achieve 100 gigawatts, I think it is quite a challenging one, because as such in the distributor rooftop segment, we find it as a challenge that achieving 40 gigawatts by 2030 is a dream, because I think we have achieved 1.3 gigawatts and to even if you're talking about exponential growth rates, achieving 13 gigawatts by 2022 would be a great thing. So we find it's going to be a really a challenging one. But the government is doing enormous amount of things, enormous amount of schemes they're bringing out for rooftop. But this is a space, I think, which is going to grow. And hopefully, people who are in this industry would continue to make wafer thin margins. I think Any industry would not survive with wafer thin margins. So it's very important to see that the industry is also sustainable. Then only you can invest. Otherwise, it does not make sense investing into an industry which gives you wafer thin margins. And the present scenario, it's really challenging, I must say.
Yeah. Thank you, Niranjan. I think you come out with the clear and true words instead of beating around the bush. It is the condition today. So I would like, since he's a EPC player, Sushant, what is your view on the current trend which is going on and which way it is going? It is going towards the dark jungle or it is going in open market?
Hello. Okay. So current scenario is, the aggressive rates that pursuing, as Niranjan sir said, the quality of installation, yes, it's really dwindling like anything. Means if you see, the most of the people don't understand about the modules even. Means, Hello. Yeah. So, if you see on the entire solar modules, people don't understand the modules. So there are many, if you go into the module quality, it's like dwindling like anything. Means there are so much of, people are not at all been looking into the module qualities that is happening on. So Relyon Solar, in we have specialized in this module qualities. We have we are one of the very handful companies in India who can specify the module BOM, what should be its quality standard, and ensure that the quality is being maintained in the solar modules. And current aggressive trends in solar industry is pushing the EPC companies to go aggressive and cutting corners on that. So yes, this is definitely affecting a lot on the quality of the installation. The another trend I'm seeing is which many of us or many of companies, Indian companies, are not exploring is the products. So if you see the entire solar industry, there is 95% of the foreign content is there. So focusing over there is an important thing, developing own technology, innovations, and that will make you a sustainable in this field. So we have developed a different kind of this product which will ensure that the help Indian companies to have the next generation products in the available indigenously. So for example, we have a single axis tracker which will ensure that the higher generation and help maintain the IRRs in the ground mount project. Trackers can give you around 18 to 20% of additional generation in Indian geographies.
Right. Thank you, Sushant. I think that's the current status, but future lies with what Nitin will inform us. I think he's talking about storage. I think that is the future for solar. Suppose you don't have anybody to buy the energy today, you can store it and sell it later on when the market is better.